Shall we look God in prayer? Holy and eternal God, we thank you and praise you for this wonderful morning. Thank you for the gift of life. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the joy as we come into your presence. Thank you for each and every blessings which we receive from you. Thank you, Lord, you have been our strength and our comfort during the time of struggles, during the times of challenges. Loving God, as we come into your presence, speak to us. You have given this one more day in our life that we may come to you and please you through our lives. May the words of my mouth and meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord God, our rock and our salvation. Amen. Friends, I bring greetings to you in the blessed name of Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It has been a wonderful day. The days when we struggle, when we see so many things happening in and around us. And particularly from last 2 days, the whole world is glued to TV. To be there, to watch some very exciting things which is happening in Tokyo Olympic 2020. And the whole India rejoiced yesterday when one of the daughter, all the way from Northeast, she brought the glory to our country, winning the silver medal, Chanu Mirabai. She won the silver medal. Congratulations for India to begin a journey with silver in this Olympic. Then also yesterday, our Padri also, he mentioned the two sons of Christchurch, Orai and Darius. They brought glory to themselves and also to the family and also to the Christchurch. We praise God for their success in their examinations. Congratulations to both of you. And as you take the journey for the next year, next of your life, may God guide you, advise you, and take you that where he wants to plant you to bring fruits for the whole world and for your family and for the church. One more thing. We celebrate the life of Apostle James. He was right there during the time of transfiguration of Jesus. We see that he suffered for the sake of the gospel. He was right there, jealous. And this is why known as the sons of thunder, full of energy. For what? To please God through his services. And that is wonderful. The church today, when we stand as the body of Christ, and we thank God for James the apostles, along with John, along with all the other disciples and the elder Peter. Friends, during this pandemic time, we all are worried. We all are worried, and particularly what is happening to Indian Christians. And we have started realizing that something somewhere is not correct. We all were heartbroken when we saw the big boulders when they came to Delhi and broke the church. It was a sad part to see the body of Christ, the building particularly, is being demolished. We just went into prayer. Then we see in our Northeast how the things on your food habits are being imposed. And sometimes we start realizing what there is going wrong. Is this world where we need to have a life in abundance and a freedom for each and everyone, the respect, where it is going. And I think that is making us sad. And during this pandemic time, I think that none of us are untouched by the devastating news of departure of some of our very dear, very known people, that they are no more with us. Then it start thinking, what will happen? What is the guarantee? What is the warranty that I will live a life tomorrow? Then the thought comes, what will happen if something goes wrong? Where will I go? And then this morning, Jockey, he sent some photographs, the cemetery being renovated, and it looks very nice. But the Bible says this body will go for sure. What will happen to our soul? And that is the important question which you and me, we need to ponder upon. Am I pleasing God? And then Paul, he very, very rightly, he says, he exhorts Christians to lead a life which is pleasing to God. Now the question comes for you and for me, when we say all Christians live a life which is pleasing to God, then for us, am I pleasing God? And what are the things which please God? And there are several attitudes which makes us to think. And one of the things which we take it for guaranteed, I am born in a Christian family, that must be pleasing God, isn't it? And I have met so many people, and they have told me that I was born in a Christian family, I was born in a Christian environment, so of course that must be pleasing God. Others, they have said, I have been Christian throughout my life, and this must be pleasing God. Is it not pleasing? My question to them is, from where does it determine that being born in Christian family or being born in Christian environment pleases God? For example, one donkey might be born in a stable. That does not mean that it is a horse. It will remain a donkey. So for my friends, let us be thankful for God gave us our families, and we call Christian family. The upbringing we had, the nurture we had. But I tell you that being born in Christian family is not the guarantee that your life is pleasing God. One more thing, we think that living a good life, living a very good life, it will be pleasing God. Then again, the living a clean and a moral life definitely does not please God. Many atheists live a decent, straight, disciplined life. Anyway, how good is good? That is the real issue. Many people have the idea to measure your goodness and my goodness. For example, if we compare ourselves to a mask, you know, to the criminals, we are ready for the sainthood. That we will become a saint in that, if we compare to those people. Even if we compare to some of our family members also, we will be saying, I am much better, isn't it? I am much, much better. But my dear friends, remember, the world always had good people, and plenty of good people are around. So if the goodness were enough, God need not send Jesus Christ to this world. So your goodness and living a life of very pure and straight is not guarantee that you are pleasing God. One more important thing. If we go to church and attend the church services, it must be pleasing God, isn't it? No doubt. And it is a joy When we come to church, when we worship our God, it is indeed a joy. People go to church because it is a social habit. Every Sunday we need to be right there in the church. People, they go because their pastor, their padre is so good. He encourages people and he gives a very positive positive thoughts. And also, so listening to him, it gives us a very joy. So we go to church. And then some of us, we like music. What about singing? What about, you know, that we praise God all together? Oh, people, they go to church for that. And remember, people, they come for the confirmation classes. People, they go to baptism classes. People also, they go during the time of the marriage counseling and they go to the church. And there are several reasons. I remember the story right back in 1998 when I was attending a church service in St. Paul's Cathedral. And cathedral service in the Christmas time, midnight service, it starts right at 11 o'clock. But then the crowd will be there. If you are late, then you are not going to get the seat. So we were right there, sitting there. And still there was a time. And I started chatting with my neighbor. And then I asked him, where are you from? He said, I have just come today from New York. I just looked at him. I said, oh, wow. I said, welcome. So you want to celebrate your Christmas here? Then he says, see that last year, my wife, she died. And she belonged to this church. And throughout her life, she used to come on this midnight to start her Christmas celebration. Now she is no more. So just to please, just to pray that she may be rested in peace, it was my moral duty that I must come to the church. So I have come all the way from New York to attend this church service, midnight service. He said, I am not a Christian, but my wife, she was Christian. My friends, it is true, we go to church for several reasons and it takes very active part in its life. But then going to church, coming to church, does it please God? One more thing which we all understand, giving, you know, when we give. And the Bible teaches us to be a good stewards. The time, talents, and the treasures we must give to God. It is our Christian understanding, Christian duty, we say, that from our income, whatever we earn, we must give for the kingdom of God. But then, my dear friends, there are so many people, they give for the welfare of the society. They give to the poor and the needy. Prince Charles, he donates a bigger part of his income for the Nobel works throughout the world. And I'm sure you also, we know that there are several people, they give the part of their income for the welfare of the people. My dear friends, we may give everything, still, we cannot please God. Bible says, Isaiah chapter 1, verses 11, 12 and 13, Lord God says, I hate all these of your gifts and your offerings. I have enough. What can we give to God? He says, I have absolutely enough. They have become burden to me. Friends, we can give always everything you have, but still we will not be able to please God. When we talk about God, does it please God? You know, there is a very lovely book which I read long back. It was a book which I still remember was given to me by Reverend Dango in my early ministry. And the name of the book was God Talk. God Talk. So it is our talk about God. How? We talk about God. And some of our dear friends, they have read so beautifully and they know so much about God and they talk. Colonel James Irwin, He is remembered for Apollo 15 moon mission. And after this successful mission, he was asked by the journalist, "Oh, you talk about God so much, but why are you not a Muslim?" You know, that the talking about God is not only that we only Christian people, we talk about. Our brothers Hindus, they speak about God. Muslim brothers and sisters, they also talk about God. My friend, talking to God does not please God. Praying makes you to please God. Yes, praying is a part of our life. I think we start our mornings starting with prayer and we end with prayer. And every meal we have, we thank God. That's beautiful. It's wonderful. And then, does it please God? I think we live in a multicultural society, pluralistic context. And we see our dear friends from Hindu background, they pray all the time. They go to temples one after another. We see that Muslim pray people, they pray 5 times in a day. How many times do Christian people they pray? We pray. It is for you and for me. Yes, it is important that the prayer should be the part of our habit to pray to God. Egyptian president Sadat, wherever he goes, he takes a small mat wherever he goes. And when the time comes, whether he is flying or he is going anywhere, he just spread his mat and he prays. But remember, he was not a Christian. He was a Muslim, praying 5 times a day. Isaiah says, chapter 1, verse 15 says, "When you stretch your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen to you." Oh, God can turn away to our prayers. My dear friends, one more thing which we think. Reading the Bible. And then there is one more thing which is going on. A very famous actress, Kareena Kapoor, she wrote one book during her pregnancy time, and she gave the name title also Pregnancy Bible. And there is a lot of protest why she should give the name Bible. See, Bible becomes pure. Bible becomes a part of our life, not by wrapping it in a nice cloth and keeping somewhere on the shelf. No. Bible becomes pure when we read it, meditate it, and definitely when we obey the way of Jesus Christ. That is what telling us. So Karl Marx, when he was 17 years old, he wrote a fantastic explanation or a commentary on St. John's Gospel. And the many of the theologians, they were agreed what he said. But later on, Karl Marx, he rejected the authority of the Bible. My dear friends, you must be thinking what happened to Bishop Michael today. You must be saying that, you know, going to church is not pleasing God. Then singing is not praying to God and reading the Bible, and it is not pleasing. And then what is that which pleases God? It is something which is very extraordinary. Then what is that way which can please God? My dear friends, we saw this beautiful readings. You know, in the gospel passage, we saw a beautiful lessons there. Then we read about Naaman. And I want to focus on the what pleasing God, particularly for you and for me. You and me, we never know. In fact, we do not have time. Today's the day that we must realize that what God wants from my life, from our life. Tomorrow is not guaranteed whether you will be there or not. I will be there or not. Nobody can guarantee. But God can guarantee that we can please our God. First, Our life is pleased to God when we walk in the way of life. John chapter 14 verse 6 says, and you can ask what kind of way it is. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth and the life, and no one can come to the Father except by me. So Jesus Christ is the way. If Jesus is right there in your life, you are pleasing your life to God. Jesus also spoke, Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, he says about narrow and the wide road. And then you see this world, every time we talk about the wide road, comfortable journey, that is not the Christian life. That life is not the life which pleases God, a life which struggles. And when Jesus is there in your life, who says there will always be comfort? No. Look at James, he suffered. Look at the disciples, how they suffered. Look at the Paul, he suffered because of the sake of the gospel. My dear friends, when Jesus is in our life, rest assured, your life is pleasing to God, and for sure, that is absolutely sure. But then, remember, in our time, that we all need to suffer for the sake of the Christ. But then the beautiful word says, those who suffer because of my name, they are acceptable in the sight of God. You sometimes, my dear, you feel that you are lost. Sometimes do you feel? You don't know where you are going every morning, evening, and then it is happening. And then again, the days are rotating and it is becoming cycle. And then we are just keep rotating. When you find Jesus, you will find the way of life. Many people, when they found Jesus, they turned the whole world upside down. I can name one after another. These people, they left their comfortable life, but for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of Jesus, they left everything and they walked the way of Jesus Christ. Then you will ask, what kind of way it is of Jesus Christ? Friends, it is the way of peace. It is the way of peace. God's peace fill our hearts. When you and me, we walk in the way of Christ. Jesus said to his followers, Jesus is saying to you and to me, peace, I live with you. And this peace is not like the world which gives. Let your heart not be troubled. My dear friends, that is the way of peace which comes to us. It is beyond our understanding. The peace which fills our heart. And Jesus says, that peace I want to give you. Then, the way of life is also, which is the life of purity. Bible says, Matthew chapter 5 verse 8 says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. They will see God. My dear friends, we may be very nice people. Perhaps we are the soul of any party which is going around. Perhaps without me or without us, nothing will happen. You know, if that mindset is there. But if we are playing with immorality, that's what Paul was saying. If we are playing with immorality, with corruption, if you and me are not being truthful in our own businesses, if we are not honest, or if we are dishonest in our schools, in our work, in our family life, then you and me are not loving, not living the way Jesus wants you and me to live. When you come to Christ, he forgives all our trespasses and purifies our hearts. God gives us the power to live a righteous life. Then, so I talked about the way of life. I talked about the way of purity. The way of life in Christian, in Christ is also the way of love. Purity and then love. What says, Bible says, John chapter 13 verse 35 says, all people will know that you are my disciple when you love one another. Love your God as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. So the way of life of Jesus Christ is the way of love. That means we must love. Unfortunately, today, this love has become not L-O-V-E, it has become L-U-V. That means I love you, but I have some wasted interest. I have some wasted interest. Much of the time, it is used to describe a person exploiting nature. And then for own satisfaction and for own selfishness. Look how God he loved. He did not have any of his selfishness. He loved the world so much that he gave his only son, Jesus Christ. So we need to love one another till it hurts us badly. Jesus says, love one another. Love your God and love your neighbor. Then a life is pleased to God, which has eternal life. Beautiful verse. The verse 3:16, Sunday school verse, throughout our life as we go to old age also. Beautiful. John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, Jesus Christ, that those who believe in him will never perish, but will have eternal life. Now, this beautiful verse, and then John chapter 10, verse 10 says, I have come that you may have life, and life in all its fullness. If you know Jesus, who says in John chapter 10, verse 28, he said, I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. Oh, this is a triple security. You know, now we talk about what is security. Safety and security is becoming our question. If you buy a cloth, also you are asking, what is the safety? What is the security of this one? If you buy any product, we say, oh my goodness, what is the safety features it has? You buy a mobile phone, what are the features it has? You know, 1, 2, 3, and we keep counting. And here Jesus is saying, John chapter 10, verse 28, beautiful, says that he says that I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. That means here, this one is talking about triple security, three security. What are these three securities? It says, I give them eternal life. Oh, what a wonderful thing. Body may perish. The life in Jesus is eternal. You shall live your life. Then what it says, the life which Jesus wants to give you will never perish. Never perish. He said it will remain youthful, young, energy, and fresh. Life in Jesus is fresh. Second, and the third one is a beautiful, it says, the life which God wants to give us, nobody can snatch. You keep your purse somewhere, gone. No security. Now, if you are keeping all our money into bank, you never know what will happen. Some fraud may happen, and then suddenly you come a message and you come to know, oh my goodness, your bank balance is zero. No security. There is no security of life. But Jesus says, I will give them eternal life that will never perish. Nobody would be able to snatch it from me. That is the wonderful promise which Jesus is saying. John, 1 John chapter 5, verse 12 says, he who has the Son has the life. Do you have Son? Do you have Jesus in your life? In other words, eternal life is having Christ in our life. So can you say, during this time of pandemic, can we examine ourselves and we say, oh yes, I have that eternal life. I am sure about that one. Beautiful. Your life is pleased to God when Jesus is right there. Thirdly, you can please God when you are born in the God's family. See, we all of us, we are born. And then we praise God for our family. According to the Bible, God is the creator of all human, but he is not the father of all. You also could become a member of God's family by being born into God's family. The Lord Jesus says in John chapter 3, verse 3, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. And what does it mean to be being born again? You know, the disciples also, they came, and the many people, they came to Jesus and they said, how can I be born again? It is impossible. Here, the meaning is that we repent from our sins. The day we repent, we surrender our life into the hand of God and say, Lord, this is my life, which I want to give you, is the spiritual birth which we have. We have. Then, what's the important? Dr. W. Graham, he said, repent. Repent is the word. Repent from all our sins. Friends, today we have to take a decision, because the Bible says, John chapter 1 verse 12, beautiful verse. It says, to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. Oh, what a wonderful thing. Do you want to be in the family of God? And he says, repent, come to the fold. Let me ask you, are you ready to celebrate your spiritual birth? Or I will say, on the 25th of July, right now today, I want to be born again. I want to repent. I want to take Jesus as my Savior. My life will be pleased to God if Jesus is there. Acts chapter 4 verse 12 says, there is no other name which is given to us who has the salvation. It is the name of Jesus. My dear, have you decided to trust Christ? Would you like to know that you have eternal life? Would you like to start walking in the way of Jesus Christ? Let me tell you quickly, your life will be pleased to God. The first of all, that we must admit that our sins have separated us from God. The first thing, that we all are sinful, and this is why this has separated us from God and from us. Our selfishness, our pride, our greed, immorality, and all the rest I can keep on talking about. Bible says, Romans chapter 3 verse 23, all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. Friends, this is the time that we own up all the mistakes of our life and ask God, please God, forgive my sins. If we do that one, you know that God is a forgiver. Our God is the only God who forgives. He never looks back to our sinful nature, our sins. He forgives you and for me. But we need to come and say, Lord, yes, I am sinful. Mistakes, deliberate or otherwise, bring it to the feet of Jesus. He will forgive each one of us. Then, one more way we can go ahead. We must believe what Christ has done for us right on the cross. I told you that several people have come, good people, they have come and gone. Nobody was there on the cross. The cross is the symbol for you and for me, for our salvation. This life is pleasing to God. This cross is not the despised thing. It is the holy symbol of you and for me, because all our sins have been washed right on the cross with the bleeding of the blood. Every drop which was being shed right on the cross has salvation, has a power to purify for you and for me. And my dear, the Christ died for you and for me. Believe what Jesus has done right on the cross for you and for me. And then, the last thing which I want to tell you today, we must confess Jesus Christ as our Savior, as our Lord. We cannot say, "Arey, my mummy was very good Christian. Arey, my papa was very Christian." No, 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 no. You must confess. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10 say, if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is the Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him right from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and you are being saved. Your life is pleasing to God. The best way I know to make Jesus the Lord of our life is simply to bow ourselves in reverence and confess our sins to God, and with faith ask Christ to come, believe in him, receive him. If that is your decision today, and as we realize, maybe I may be nominal Christian, but my life is pleased to God when Jesus is right there with me. And if that is the decision of yours and mine today to walk the way of Jesus Christ, that life is pleased to God. Remember, Bible says, when one sinner repents from his or her sin, there is a great joy in heaven. Can there be joy in heaven today? It is because of you, because of me, because we surrender our life in the life of God. Let me sing this very beautiful, beautiful chorus. And I think that let us, wherever we are, let us hum it. Let us sing it gently. And it says, he is Lord, he is Lord. He has risen from the dead and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There is no other name. It is only the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, there is healing. There is forgiveness. It is available, free for you and for me. We need to just walk in to the way of Jesus. If you have decided, let us pray to God. Father, we realize that it is our sin have separated us from you. Please, Father, forgive us. We believe what Christ did for us on the cross. We may not absolutely completely understand it, but we accept it by our faith. We do want to be your children. Please come into our life, Lord Jesus, and make us your children right now. I will follow you and obey you till the last breath of my life. In the blessed name of Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. God bless you.